mighty counselor.
Counselor,
you are mighty in battle, your awesome ruler.
Ooh.
We will lift your name high each and every day. We reverence you, Lord, your mercy endures always. Let all the earth proclaim
you reign,
Lord.
Heavens and the earth declares you reign,
Lord.
Was and is always the same, you reign.
My name is Janice.
And I'm Adrian, and we're your Fondren Communication Team Leads. Praise the Lord and happy Sabbath. We are so pleased to have you join us today.
Whether you're visiting for the first time or you visit with us on a regular basis, we hope that you receive a blessing.
We understand you have a variety of choices, and we are glad that you have chosen to be with us here today.
Welcome to Fondren, where the sun
S-O-N always shines.
And it is such a blessing to be in the house of the Lord this morning. We come to lift our voices to sing of the goodness of Jesus. We come to sing of his love. We come thanking the Holy Spirit for all that he is and all that he does as he leads us into worship this morning. Holy Spirit, hear us. Help us while we sing. May your hearts be in tune. May your minds be set on godly things. And may your voices join us in song this morning. Amen.
Without you, it's like paradise. Now I know that it's real. Ooh, it's like a mystery. Why I gotta call Jesus.
hear from children's.
It's time for our children's story. Today, I brought a special guest with me, my niece named Denise, and she's going to help me tell the story today. Now, did you know when God created us, He gave everyone a very special gift? And that gift is to be able to choose. He gave us the gift of choice. Now, this gift isn't always used right. Sometimes we make bad choices. Even in heaven, the angels were able to choose whether they would follow God or not, and some of them made the right choice and some of them didn't. But today we're going to talk about our choices, but also our consequences. Now, consequence just means what happens after you make a certain choice. So an example is, maybe your mom says, you know, if you get good grades on your report card, I'll take you out for ice cream. So then you come home and you have straight A's and your mom takes you for ice cream. So you chose to make good grades and the consequence was a good one. You got ice cream. Or maybe your mom said, if you're not nice to your friend when you come over, you're not gonna get dessert today. And your friend comes over and you say, I'm not sharing my toys, this is mine. I'm not gonna be nice, you can't come in my room, and you're just really a brat the whole time. So then that night, everyone gets to have yummy apple pie for dessert and you're just sitting there. It's a bad consequence. So my niece is gonna help me with a little lesson here. Let's pretend that you want to have a very happy life and you want to do everything right. And so we're gonna pretend that that just makes this water will be a red color. So my niece is gonna put some red color in here. And let's see what happens. Okay, now she's gonna shake it up. And the consequence of her putting the red color in there is that the water is now kind of a pinkish color, right? Now, as long as she keeps making good choices, then this water will stay this color. It won't get any other color. It won't turn blue or yellow or green. It just stays this color. But maybe one day she says, you know what? I see this candy that I don't have money to buy and nobody's gonna buy it for me. Nobody will even notice if I take it. So I'm just gonna take it. So that day she made a bad choice and she's gonna put a different color in to show the bad choice. Now, do you see what's happening to the water? It's not red anymore. So the consequence is showing she made a bad choice, she got in trouble, and now the water isn't red. A lot of the times we think, if I do something bad, then all I have to do is say, I'm sorry, and everything will go back. This will be red again. But the Bible tells us a story. It's the first people who ever lived, Adam and Eve. God told them, you can enjoy the whole garden, just not this one tree, the fruit from that tree. And you know what? They made a bad choice that day because they decided, I'm gonna taste this fruit anyway. So they tasted the fruit and God gave them a consequence that was horrible. They got kicked out of the Garden of Eden. They had to work for themselves. They had to put on clothes from animal skins. Just everything changed in their world. They had a bad consequence. Now, Adam and Eve said they were sorry. Adam and Eve lived pretty good lives after that, but they never got to live in the Garden of Eden again. We all get to make choices, but sometimes the consequences from those choices doesn't go away. So as my niece is holding this water, I can apologize to it and I can say, oh, I'm sorry, I didn't mean to do anything bad. Is it turning red again, Denise? It's not turning red again. It's staying black. And the reason I wanted just to show you this is because we all get to make a choice. Every day of our lives, we can choose to be kind or mean. We can choose to tell the truth or lie. We can choose to follow God or to not follow God. But every choice that we make has a consequence. Sometimes they're good consequences. If you follow God for your whole life, you'll get to go to heaven. If you tell the truth, people will want to be around you. They'll trust you. If you're very kind, you'll probably end up with a lot of friends. But if you're mean, people might not want to be around you too much. If you say, you know what, God, your Bible sounds kind of good, but I'm not really that interested. I don't really want to live with you in heaven. He's not going to make us, because he gives us the choice, but we all have to live with whatever the consequences are. So my lesson for you today is to make good choices. Get the ice cream for making all A's. Have a lot of friends because you're a very kind and honest person. But most importantly, I hope you all get to live in heaven with God forever because you've chosen to follow him. All right, that's it, boys and girls. See you next week.
Has come for us to seek the Lord in prayer. We know that God has been with us throughout this week, and as we come to call upon his name, we're mindful that he cares for us, that he watches over us, and that he will always be with us. Let us pray. Father in God, we come as a community of believers, some in the room and some watching. We are pausing to call upon your name, O God, because we realize that we are in communication with you. You have welcomed us into the throne of grace to be able to call upon your name. And with thanksgiving, we come, O God, recognizing that you are an ever-present help in times of need. Lord, we are mindful that we are living in this age, in this time, in this country, when certain things are about us. We have been living for almost all of 2020 in a state of a quarantine, realizing that this COVID-19 has affected the lives of many in this country and throughout the world. Others have died, and even now as we move towards the end of this year, we are even mindful that this pandemic will have an impact on how we gather to celebrate what has been during this time of year, a time of family gatherings. So, oh Father, we pray that for all of us who are even moving forward towards this time, that your Holy Spirit's presence will continue to protect and to keep. Then, Lord, there's been unrest throughout the summer. And even now, as we head towards an event this coming Tuesday in the United States, that will have a saying on which way this country will go, we know, oh God, that we rest and keep our assurance in you. For we realize, oh God, that no man is ever able to bring about the salvation that only you can provide. Loving Lord, we pray that as believers in the everlasting God, we might be the catalyst, the source of light, if we will, to others, so that darkness can be dispelled. Help us, O loving God, to be able to take a stand against error, a stand against evil, and that others might be able to see that we have purpose and intent because God has been with us. We have come today, O God, to worship on your day. And because of this gathering, we are so ever thankful, O God, that even in a room that is not filled as it was before the pandemic, the Holy Spirit and angels are still with us. And so, loving Lord, we invite your holy presence not only into the room but in our hearts, that we might be able to receive a blessing, a encounter, a experience that only comes when heaven comes down and showers upon us your presence. We pray, oh God, for our missing pastoral leadership who is ministering in other areas, and we're thankful, oh God, that they are able to do so. For God, we are only wanting to advance the gospel because we know there is a day coming soon when your return will find us all either ready to return with you or unprepared. Oh, merciful God, may we all be in the prepared area so that we might be able to spend eternity with thee. Now we ask that you would have a special anointing for our speaker who will come later to give us words of life. May we, oh God, be able to declare that it was good that we were in the house of the Lord. Here we are in this room in a very present sense, and those who are with us in a virtual sense. May your blessings flow either way. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
And family, I hope you have learned a lot during these last couple of weeks where we've had the Fondren Fit for Life Cancer Awareness. During these last couple of weeks, we've learned about different cancers that affect men and women, young and old. And what I'd like to leave with you are ways in which we can decrease our risks as for getting cancer, as well as risks for other chronic diseases. Number one, I want you to get fit, get moving. When you do increase your physical activity, it actually helps to lower your weight, and it also helps to increase the endorphins that help you increase your immunity. Number two, I want you to think of your body as a brand new Mercedes or BMW. You put the best gas in those type of cars, and in your body, you want to put the best food in there as well. So focus on eating non-processed foods, but foods that are whole foods, plant-based foods, one-ingredient foods. Those will help you to have the best building blocks for your body. Number three, lots of water. When you drink lots of water, it flushes out the impurities in your system. And then lastly, rest. It's important to get enough rest so that you can rest your mind and your body. This helps to increase your immune system. And lastly, I want you to think about ways and implement ways that will decrease your stress. When you have high stress levels, it actually causes inflammation throughout the body, and it's hard for your body to actually fight off disease. So with those things in mind, I hope you have used this month to take your health inventory, and it's not too late. If you have not been to your physician for a checkup, make sure you do so. Talk to your family and friends and encourage each other. So remember that your body is the temple of God, and He can give you the willpower to help you make these important changes so that you can improve your lifestyle and your health, and so that you will be able to be fit for life. Until next time, God bless.
Hello, Fundrin family and friends. This month of October, Fundrin Fit for Life will be focusing on cancer awareness. Today, we are highlighting prostate cancer. Make sure you have your light blue on. This year, over 170,000 men will be diagnosed with prostate cancer, and it is the second leading cause of cancer death for American men. Most prostate cancer is diagnosed in men older than 65. However, in African American men, the disease starts at younger ages and grows faster than other ethnic groups. You are at an increased risk of prostate cancer if you have a father, brother, or son who has had the disease. When prostate cancer is found early, the survival rate is nearly 100%. So, it is important to get screening. If you have symptoms including difficulty with urination, difficulty emptying your bladder completely, frequent nighttime urination, blood in urine, or pain in your pelvic area that does not go away, it is important that you go and get evaluated by your doctor. There are some things you can do to decrease your risk of prostate cancer. Lifestyle habits have been found to be important in both preventing and treating the disease. Eat a whole food plant-based diet. Eat foods that are rich in lycopene. Such foods include tomatoes, watermelon, pink grapefruit, and guavas. Also eat foods that are high in selenium, such as Brazilian nuts, mushrooms, tofu, whole wheat pasta. Also, increase your physical activity by exercising regularly. So we encourage all men with a family history of prostate cancer or over the age of 65 years to get your screening. Don't delay.
You may have asked yourself, should I get screened for prostate cancer? The answer is, talk with your doctor. Learn what's involved. Then decide if prostate cancer testing is right for you. In 2018, the United States Preventive Services Task Force, a group of health experts, concluded that men 55 to 69 benefit most from a prostate cancer screening test. The main test for prostate cancer measures blood levels for prostate-specific antigen, or PSA. A higher than normal PSA level does not mean you have prostate cancer. PSA levels could be high for other reasons, like an enlarged prostate, prostate infection, or taking certain medicines. Your doctor may ask you to repeat the test or recommend a biopsy, taking a tiny sample of prostate tissue to send to the lab to check for cancer. Before you get tested, ask a doctor about the possible benefits and harms of PSA testing. Benefits include knowing your PSA level, which can help your doctor determine your chance of having prostate cancer. Also, finding prostate cancer early may make treatment easier. However, the test can have negative consequences as well. Because PSA levels are sometimes high when cancer isn't present, the test may give a false positive result, which can cause unnecessary worry and additional tests. Furthermore, PSA testing can't always tell which prostate cancers are deadly and which ones won't cause problems. Most prostate cancers grow slowly, So treatment may not be needed right away and might do more harm than good. Your doctor may recommend active surveillance, which includes regular checkups and tests to see if the cancer grows, then treat it if it does. Prostate cancer treatment, however, can cause serious side effects like impotence and loss of bladder control. Learn more about PSA screening and prostate cancer at cdc.gov/cancer/prostate.
Our scripture reading this morning is found in Mark, the 5th chapter, and we want to focus our attention on verses 25 through 34. Mark, the 5th chapter, verses 25 to 34. The word of God reads, "A woman in the crowd has suffered for 12 years with constant bleeding. She has suffered a great deal from many doctors, and over the years, she has spent everything she had to pay them, but she had gotten no better. In fact, she had gotten worse. She had heard about Jesus, so she came up behind him through the crowd and touched his robe. For she thought to herself, 'If I can just touch his robe, I will be healed.' Immediately, the bleeding stopped, and she could feel in her body that she had been healed of her terrible condition. Jesus realized at once that healing power had gone out from him. So he turned around in the crowd and asked, 'Who touched my robe?' His disciples said to him, 'Look at this crowd pressing around you. How can you ask who touched me?' But he kept on looking around to see who had done it. Then the frightened woman, trembling at the realization of what had happened to her, came and fell to her knees in front of him and told him what she had done. And he said to her, 'Daughter, your faith has made you well. Go in peace. Your suffering is over.'" Oh, there's sometimes that you don't need permission to get a healing from the Lord. May this rich story grant to us a blessing, I pray.
Rejected, often criticized, hid behind the childhood lies. Everything has changed since the blood. Since the blood. Since the blood. Oh, the blood.
Thank you. Privilege to be with you this morning. We want to thank our young people for a phenomenal job. Fantastic job. It's a beautiful thing when young people use the gifts that God has given to them to advance His kingdom. And so we rejoice with you this morning. Also, our musicians, thank you very much. Our services are enhanced as a result of you utilizing the gifts that God has given you as well to advance the kingdom of God. I want to thank the pastors Jones and Mota, for this privilege to be able to minister to God's people this morning. You know, COVID-19 has changed everything in our lives. And I don't like the restrictions I never liked the restrictions before. Makes it worse now with COVID, having to stand behind a desk and not having the congregation in front of you is different. It makes things different, and so people are not in your homes now listening to us, and so we're happy that you are listening to us. I want to address the two elephants in your room, not in this room. Well, we have some individuals here, but most of us are in our own rooms or in our cars. Let's address those two elephants. One is COVID-19. COVID-19, like I said, has changed everything. But in addition to that, we have reached a stage now where we're becoming tired. And we are letting our guards down. And so we're not doing what we were doing before, because it is tiring, it is getting on our nerves, and we want to get rid of it. However, we need to be more vigilant. We need to recognize that it is getting worse. The cases are beginning to increase, deaths are increasing, everything is increasing, and so we need to get back to being vigilant and wearing our masks and washing our hands, social distancing, and using gloves when we have to. The second elephant in the room is happening on November 3rd. I was just admitting to Elder Rodriguez that indeed that is one of the things that is stressing me out. November 3rd, 2020. So, but one of the things I recognize is that, so the advice I'm giving you is not just for you, but it's also that I need to take for myself. And that is, number one, whatever it is that God designs is going to happen, is going to happen. And because God is in control, we need to be at peace, whatever the outcome is. Because there can be any outcome. But whatever it is, we need to be reminded that God is in control. And so if God is in control, everything is going to work out. Everything is going to work out all right. All right, we're dealing with the subject, how does the spiritual work? How does the spiritual work? I'm doing some research on a book that I'm writing now, How to Solve Our Problems in Life. And some of the things that I'm discovering is that there are some foundations that are to be laid before we can get to solving our problems. And one of them is, how does the spiritual work? One of our challenges as human beings is that we love to isolate. And our objective as human beings for isolation is for domination. And the objective of domination is going to eventually, if it is unchecked, is going to lead to death. And so God has designed us as human beings with several different components. So if you look at 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 and verse 23, tells us that the Lord wants to sanctify us wholly. And that holy is not H, that's W-H-O-L-L-Y. It's important you understand that. We're going to tie that in at coming down to the end of the presentation. But it's important to understand that we are comprised of, if you read 1 Thessalonians 5, verse 23, he's going to sanctify us wholly, spirit, soul, and body. So we are comprised of three components, just like of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit comprise of three components. But his objective is to make them one, to make us whole as a result. And so we need to be aware of the fact that we consist of three parts. But here's what we do. As human beings, we love to separate them. God wants us to integrate them rather than separate them. And so we're going to look now at how the spiritual works. But before we do that, there's another text that we need to look at first. 1 Corinthians chapter 3 and verse 9, which says that God has made us laborers together with him. So we are laborers together with God. And so understanding those two concepts, that we are spirit, soul, and body, and they need to be integrated as one and not separated, we need to be aware also, according to 1 Corinthians chapter 3 and verse 9, that we are laborers together with God. With that in mind then, how does the spiritual work? I wanted to declare to you that when it comes to the spiritual, we think that, at least I've been taught, that the spiritual happens immediately, instantaneously. It happens miraculously. And so it just happens in the blink of an eye. And that is true. However, the spiritual never takes place unless the physical is involved. As a matter of fact, as you're going to see, it is important that the foundation be laid for the spiritual to take place. Okay, let's see if we can use a few examples. Let's use the example of righteousness. Is righteousness a spiritual concept or is it a man-made concept? Most of us will agree that it is a spiritual concept. So how does righteousness work then? How does righteousness work? How do we live righteously? How do we become righteous? Yes, righteousness is a spiritual concept, but do you know that righteousness is also a physical concept? So let me ask you. Do you think that we have righteousness of our own as human beings? It's okay. Those of you here, you want to answer me, that'll be fine as well. Because I love the interaction. I hate this dead, the silence. Because as you're aware, I love teaching. That's the area that I love. I enjoy doing, and even getting pushback from you, if you want to do that. Pardon me? We don't have righteousness? As someone in the congregation saying, no, we don't have righteousness. You said no. Anybody else? What's that? In and of ourselves. Okay. If you turn to 2 Samuel chapter 22, 2 Samuel chapter 22 and verse 21, you will discover there that David asked God to remember my righteousness, which was David's righteousness. If you go to Job chapter 27 and verse 6, Job told the Lord that he's going to hold fast to my righteousness, which was his righteousness. He wasn't talking about God's righteousness. He was talking about his righteousness. And if you go to another one that is found where, yes, Psalm 7 and verse 8. If you look at Psalm 7 and verse 8, the book of Psalms, Psalm 7 and verse 8, where the Bible says, again, David saying to God that he should judge him based on his righteousness. Again, which is David's righteousness. And the reason why we do have it is because we are made in the image of God. And being made in the image of God, whatever God possesses, we possess. That's what image means. I'm made in the image of my Father, and therefore, as being made in the image of my Father, I have what my Father has. However, I can never become my Father. In the same way, we can never become God. So don't try to mix them up or try to say I'm saying something that doesn't exist. So when we begin to understand, then, that we do have righteousness. But Isaiah says in Isaiah 64 and verse 6 that all our righteousness is as filthy rags. So even though we have righteousness, that righteousness has been corrupted as a result of sin. And therefore, our righteousness has got to become righteous from God's standpoint. That's why 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 17 says, therefore, if any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. All things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. And therefore, our righteousness has got to become, therefore, God's righteousness, which becomes the pure righteousness that we need in order to live and to exist. However, once we are converted now, how do we continue living righteously for God? If you turn to 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 16 says that all scripture is given by the inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, and for instruction in righteousness. So how do we continue living righteously? What's that? Yes. All scripture is given by the inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instructions in righteousness. So even though we are converted now and we have the righteousness of Christ living in us, the way we continue living righteously is that we have got to be taught how to live righteously. That's what the Bible says. All scripture is given by the inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instructions in righteousness. So you've got to be instructed, therefore, how to continue living righteously. I want you to notice something you're going to see throughout the entire presentation, and that is that we're involved in the before the miraculous takes place, we're involved. Then miraculous takes place, and then we become involved again. And we tend to miss that because we don't understand how the spirit, many of us don't understand, not everybody, don't understand how the spiritual works, and I didn't understand it myself. So when you look at the aspect of righteousness, then even though God bestows, is a gift from God, even though he bestows it upon us miraculously, instantaneously, it doesn't happen unless the foundation is laid by us. Okay, so how do miracles work then? We looked at righteousness. How do miracles work? Again, miracles are spiritual. I'm not going to ask you that because I wouldn't insult your intelligence. So miracles are spiritual, and they happen instantaneously, they happen miraculously, they happen instantaneously. But do you realize that before God performs any miracle on the face of the earth, man has to lay the foundation for it to take place? Except in Genesis, where when God created this universe, before Adam and Eve were created, then he just created. But any time after that, and if you can find a miracle in the Bible where man was not involved in laying the foundation, please share it with me. Or even now, if you can think of one, you can even present it now. But let's look at some examples. In the book of Exodus, Exodus chapter 14. When you go to the book of Exodus chapter 14, you'll discover that the children of Israel were freed from Egypt and they were heading to Canaan, well, in the wilderness before they headed to Canaan. When they got to the Red Sea in Exodus chapter 14, the armies of Israel were behind them. Mountains were on both sides, and so they were trapped. And as they were trapped, they began to complain to Moses. And Moses, being the leader that he was, said to them, man, just in 13 and 14, he says, just stand still and see what God is about to do for you. But God didn't do anything for them until they had to do something for themselves. Let's look at verses 13 and 14. And Moses said unto the people, fear ye not, stand still and see the salvation of the Lord, which he will shew to you today. For the Egyptians whom ye have seen today, ye shall see them no more. The Lord shall fight for you, and ye shall hold your peace. So when Moses told him to stand still, he didn't mean to stand still physically. He meant that they needed to stand still mentally. That's right. That's exactly right. Spiritually. They were to stand still in faith, not in action. Because God was about to do something, but God did not do something until verses 15 and 16. And the Lord said unto Moses, wherefore criest thou unto me? Speak unto the children of Israel that they go forward. So the children of Israel were to do something before the miracle took place. Not only were they to do something, but also Moses had to do something. Look at verse 16. But lift up thou thy rod and stretch out thine hand over the sea and divide it, and the children of Israel shall go on dry ground through the midst of the sea. So the miracle did not take place until what? Moses stretched out his hand. It did not take place until the children of Israel went forward. After they went forward, then the miracle took place. Let's see if we can use another example. Jairus. Jairus wanted his daughter healed. And so he went looking for Jesus, found Jesus, and was leading Jesus to his house in order to heal his daughter. Notice that he had to find Jesus, lead Jesus to his house. Now he didn't have, Jesus didn't have to go to his house. Because if you look at Matthew chapter 8, verses 8 to 10, when the centurion wanted his servant healed, he said to Jesus, come to my house and take care of this, of my servant. But then he remembered that he is a man of under authority, and whenever he says go to one soldier, he goes. When he says come, he comes. And he realized that Jesus was not one who was worthy to even come under his roof. All Jesus had to do was speak the word, and his servant was going to be healed. And Jesus was so pleased with what he said that he said he has not found such great faith in Israel. And so you notice that the Jairus, therefore, had to find Jesus and had to lead Jesus to his house. And what I find is fascinating about that is that even though Jesus didn't have to go to his house in order to do that, because Jairus made that request, Jesus was going with him. Until the woman with the issue of blood interrupted him. And I could imagine in my sanctified imagination that as Jairus was leading Jesus, I could imagine Jairus was puffed up. He was proud. He was so excited at the fact that he was leading the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And so I could imagine his chest was pushed out, his shoulders back, and he was leading Jesus, not only Jesus, but his disciples and the crowd. Until the woman with the issue of blood interrupted him. But the point I'm making is that before he got to his house, before he healed her, Jairus had to do his part in terms of, in other words, laying the foundation, setting up the miracle so that the miracle can take place. Let's look at two more. These two blew my mind. In Matthew chapter 20, verses 29 to 34. There were two blind guys who were sitting by the road, and Jesus was passing by. And as Jesus was passing by, he asked them, they started shouting, have mercy upon us, thou son of David. Have mercy upon us. And the crowd wanted to stop them, and they could not be stopped because Jesus was there, and they wanted to get to Jesus. And Jesus stopped the procession. And as he stopped the procession, he said to them, come. Now, these are two blind men. Why would you tell them, come? But they came because they wanted to be healed. And not only that, when they came, Jesus knew what they wanted, but he asked them, what do you want? And the reason why Jesus did that was because God has given to us freedom of choice, and therefore God cannot impose upon us that which we don't want. And so they had to want it in order to, and request it in order for Jesus to do it. Because a miracle can't take place unless, as human beings, we set up for the miracle. We lay the foundation for the miracle. And we know that they came because verse 34 tells us that Jesus touched their eyes and they were healed. Here's another one in John chapter 9. The guy that was born blind. and Jesus' disciples said to him, who sinned, this guy or his parents? And Jesus said, no, none of them sin. It was done so that the works of God may be manifest. Even that I have problems with, but he's God and he knows exactly what he's doing. And so I just accept that by faith. But what is interesting about this one is that the blind man didn't ask for him to be able to see. But Jesus therefore spat on the ground, mixed up some clay, put it on his eyes, and said to him, go wash in the pool. And by the way, the pool wasn't just in the fellowship hall. And this guy was blind. And Jesus was saying to him, go wash. Why do you think Jesus told him to go and wash in the pool of Siloam? Why do you think he told him that? Faith? Remember, he didn't ask for to be able to see. He didn't ask Jesus to heal him. But he had to make the decision because the miracle can't take place unless, as human beings, we set up for the miracle. We lay the foundation for the miracle. And so he had to make a choice whether he wanted to go to the pool of Siloam or remain blind. So by just going to the pool of Siloam, he agreed that he wanted this miracle to take place. The point I'm making to us is that as human beings, how the spiritual works, as human beings, we lay the foundation so that the spiritual can intervene and take place miraculously. How are we therefore made whole? Because the way the spiritual works is that there's a connection between the spirit, the soul, and the body. And so the spirit, that's why you need all of them in order for the miracle to take place. So you don't just have the spiritual, but you also have the spiritual, the intellect, which is the soul, and you also have the body, which is the physical. So how are we made whole then? If you look at a woman with the issue of blood in our scripture reading in the book of Mark chapter 5. If you look at Mark chapter 5, you will discover that in order for that miracle to take place again, the woman with the issue of blood had to find Jesus, had to make her way to Jesus, and then touch the hem of his garment, and he was made whole. If it was the hem of his garment, because some translations has it differently, I love the hem of his garment for more than one reason, but I believe one of the reasons is if it is the hem that she literally crawled to where Jesus was, because she was unclean, and she shouldn't have been in the crowd in the first place. And so not to be observed, I believe she crawled to Jesus. Anyhow, that's my sanctified imagination. However, the point is that if you look at verse 29, Matthew 5 and verse 29, you will discover that she was healed. It is after she was healed, then Jesus asked the question, "Who touched me?" And when she came to Jesus, look at verses 33 and 34. Verses 33 and 34 says, "But the woman fearing," let's pick up from verse 32. "And he looked around about to see her that had done this to him. But the woman fearing and trembling, knowing what was done in her, came and fell down before him and told him all the truth." What is all the truth that she told him? If you read the previous verses, you'll discover that she went to every doctor in town. She spent all the money that she had and more. And she was not better. She was getting worse. So even though she was already healed now, she was healed already, but she was not yet made whole. When was she made whole? When she had the opportunity to tell her story. And we know that this is true in the area of psychology as well, that you've got to talk about what you're going through and what you've experienced in order for you to be made whole. And that's why it's a terrible thing that our church no longer allows individuals to testify. Because part of being made whole is to be able, after every miracle in our lives, for us to have the opportunity to tell our story. As a matter of fact, I just finished writing a book that I need to get published, dealing with the concept that what life is about. Life literally is about telling not our story, but his story, which is actually what is history. History is not our history, it is his story. And so he tells his story through us. And here was the woman with the issue of blood being able to tell her story, and it's after she told her story, even though she was healed, she wasn't yet made whole, because it was after she finished telling Jesus her entire story, told her the whole truth. The King James Version says she told him the whole truth. And it's after he said that, in verse 34, daughter, thy faith hath made thee whole. Let me read verse 29 to tie it in. And straightway the fountain of her blood was dried up, and she felt it in her body, and she was healed of that plague. But she was not yet made whole. Because not only do we lay the foundation for the miracle to take place, but on the back end now, human beings are still involved in the process. If you go to the same chapter, verses 18 to 20, you will discover something similar, but Jesus did it differently for Legion. Legion, after he was cured, after he was healed, wanted to go with Jesus, wanted to follow Jesus, wanted to learn from Jesus, wanted to sit at Jesus' feet. And Jesus said to him, no, you don't need to do that. You need to go to Decapolis, which is 10 cities from which you came, and tell them the things that I've done for you. See, because he didn't have a chance yet to tell his story, because he was not yet made whole. You say, but that don't apply to us today. If you go to the book of Matthew, Matthew 28, in the commission that God gave us, in Matthew 28, he says, all power and authority is given unto me. Go ye therefore and teach, baptize, and then tell them everything that I've done for you. You see the connection? So we're involved in the process up front as human beings. The miracle takes place, and then God uses us again. Now, see, we think that the spiritual is something that is separate, something that is isolated, something that is different. And so today it is spiritual because it is Sabbath. And then tomorrow is no longer Sabbath, and so therefore it's no longer spiritual. Because we love to isolate, we love to disconnect, and it's easier for us to live our lives that way. It is more challenging to integrate the spiritual, the physical, the mental, the spirit, the soul, and the body. They have got to be combined. They have got to be connected. That's why we can live our lives, spiritual lives, 24/7. When we begin to understand this concept that we also play a part in the entire process, then we begin to integrate our lives rather than separate and segregate our lives. So the way the spiritual works, my understanding of the spiritual then, is that as human beings, we set up the foundation. We lay the foundation for the miracle to take place, and then God uses us now as we are converted on the back end now to tell the story of our lives to those that he wants us to tell our stories to. Because you don't tell your story to everybody. You only tell it to those that God wants you to tell your story to. Because if you tell it to the wrong people, like Joseph, you get up, you end up being sold in. Yeah. If you David now was a smart guy. David, therefore, knew he had to tell his stories too. So, for example, when he killed the lion and the bear, I don't think he told his family. But he told his king, because he needed to tell the king, because that was his resume in order for him to, for the king to authorize him to go ahead and kill Goliath. So how does the spiritual work then? God allows us, because remember we said we are laborers together with God. We are laborers together with God. And so there isn't the isolation that we think that exists, because God wants integration. Which brings me, therefore, to us today and what I started out talking about, COVID-19. With COVID-19, we are becoming tired. And we want God, therefore, to protect us miraculously. And so there's some of us who therefore don't want to wear the mask. And we don't want to wash our hands in social distance. And we want God to protect us miraculously. He can't do that if you are not doing what you're supposed to do. And he's not going to come on the back end now and miraculously save you. But he might, because of his grace and his power. But the point is that you've got to do your part. You've got to lay the foundation. So that even perhaps, perchance, it gets into the mask, he will protect you miraculously because you have done what you're supposed to do. And then when you get home now, you've got to wash your hands, you've got to follow the procedure that needs to be followed. And so therefore, in understanding how we go about handling our problems, we've got to understand that we play a part. God allows us to play a part because we are co-laborers with him. And so may God help us. And may God direct us as we realize and recognize that we are laborers together with God. And God will work with us as we work with him in accomplishing what needs to be accomplished. You know, there's a saying that God doesn't need us, and we've been repeating it for quite a while, which is not true, biblically speaking. God needs us. Not to be God, but God needs us because he loves us. God needs us because he created us. God needs us because he wants fellowship with us. And so, may we recognize, as laborers together with God, please don't misunderstand me in saying that this is about men and this is about works. No, this is about because you are saved. This is as a result of being saved, us becoming laborers together with God, being able to set up whatever miracle there is that God wants to perform in our lives so that it can be accomplished. So may God bless you. May God keep you. May God cause his face to shine upon you and give you his peace. I pray in Jesus' name.
Just as I am without one plea, but thy blood was shed for me, and thou bidst me come to thee. conquered, I come. I come.
I know that there's been a lot of tragedy, a lot of suffering, a lot of pain. Sometimes we've even heard theologies that God helps those who help themselves. But that's a flawed theology. Because there's no way that you would know that you need help unless you're brought the awareness by the Holy Spirit. And so I know that, as Pastor Vanterpool said, when you are laying that foundation, you should be excited to know that you don't do that by yourself. You should be excited to know that God had already prepared a way so that when you lay the foundation, it's already on a durable slab. Build your foundation on the rock that is Jesus. Trust Him. Read His word. Get to know the God that was willing to give everything that He had to sacrifice His Son so that we could make a choice of choosing Him. Would you choose Him today? There's a number that's going to appear on the screen. And this number is there with elders and people that want to pray for you that are standing by. I don't know what this week has been like for you. It's been a hard week for me. But I just want to thank God that He got me through it. I want to thank God that if I had laid my foundation anywhere else, it would only guarantee that it would be built up on sand. But God wants you to build your faith on rock. So trust Him. Lay your foundation with Him and allow Him to be the miracle worker in your life. I want to pray for you now as the doors of the church are open to you at this moment. God, in the mighty name of Jesus, we just want to thank You, God, for the access that we have to even come to You, to pray to You. God, we are grateful because we know that this world would have us believe that sometimes in our darkest of moments that we are by ourselves. But God, we thank You because we know that the devil is a liar, and we know that You are stronger, and that no weapon formed against us, though the weapon might already be formed, it shall not prosper. We trust You, God. We thank You, God, for being the way maker, the miracle worker, the promise keeper, and the light in the darkness. Bless us this Sabbath as we continue to spend some time with You. Personal time with You, God. Allow us to remember today and let it bring us closer to You. It's in Jesus' name that we pray these things. Amen. And amen. And amen. It's offering time, church. And we are grateful that you have been a faithful partner with us during this time. This season has not been easy. Many people are being unemployed left and right. I know that I had a friend who was laid off this week, but she told me, "Michelle, I'm okay, Pastor, because I know that God's got better for me." And I wish that we had that mentality, that even when things aren't going right, they don't go right because we deserve them to go right. They go right because God in His mercy lets it go right. But when it goes wrong, we should still trust that the same mercy that availed itself before things went right or wrong would still be there. So that God is the one that asks you to partner with Him. And so we want to thank you, even as your pastors, for all of the loving support that we received on our Appreciation Day. It was amazing to see some of you come out here. It was great to greet you with a warm mask over the face, but still a wave and a distant hug. And we were excited to see how many of you made an effort to make sure that you poured love out on us. We're grateful that we know that our ministry makes a difference to you. And we just pray that God would continue to use us as we continue to minister to you. So we have four ways to give. You can give online. You can give over the Adventist Giving app. You can give through Cash App at the hashtag Fondren SDA Church. Or you can send it regular snail mail, which we do want to support the mail these days. So you can send it through USPS, the US Postal Service. And of course, the box outside that's here as well. We just pray that God will bestow upon you a blessing. And right now, as you give, I just want to say a quick prayer. Just stretch out your hand wherever you are as you give to God. Father, these hands that are stretched out to you right now are stretched out because we have given. And God, we are stretching out our hands, not because we expect you to give, but because we know, God, that you'll be faithful to your word. And you said, I will give, I will pour out until there's not room left. So God, pour out. We have our hands open and we are ready to receive. Bless us, Father, and keep us, not just physically, but mentally, emotionally, spiritually, and financially. And we thank you for doing these things in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen and amen. And it's time for the morning announcements.
Good afternoon, and these are our announcements for this week. We want to give a special thank you to Dr. Lindo and her team with the Fondren Fit for Life. Mm-hmm. This month, they have gone over various cancers. They've given us education and even some testimonies. We appreciate all that you've done.
And that was in October, but we are now coming up on November. It's going to happen tomorrow. I can't believe how the time is flying.
Wow.
And with November comes Thanksgiving. And we are planning a special Thanksgiving program our Fondren viewership on November the 21st.
Okay, great.
So put that on your calendar, tell your friends and families, you're not gonna wanna miss it.
Adrian, we also have a lot of things going on here at church during the week.
Yes, we do.
On Tuesday, we have Bible study. Mm-hmm. Wednesday, we have our prayer line.
Yes.
Wednesday afternoon, we have the drive-through food bank.
Yes.
Uh-huh. On Friday, we have AYS. Mm-hmm. Saturday, we have our various Sabbath school classes from the morning to even one in the afternoon.
One in the afternoon.
And we have men's ministry on Sunday. Mm-hmm. So all of those events, if you're wanting to know more information about it, check out our website, www.fondrensdachurch.org, for more information.
It's an important week coming up, Janice.
Mm-hmm.
We want to encourage everybody that as we come upon this Tuesday, which is the voting day for the country, that there's still one more day here in Houston that they will have polls open so you can vote early. But if you don't get an opportunity to do that, please don't miss your opportunity for your voice to be heard. We encourage everybody to go out, have your voice heard, and vote no later than Tuesday. It's an important thing for us as country, for us as Christians, mm-hmm. and we really, really want to encourage you to do that.
Exactly. Adrian, it's that time. Tomorrow we fall back.
I like falling back.
I know. Remember to set your clocks for that extra hour of sleep that you may get, an extended day. Sunday we fall back, so make sure you mark your calendars and your clocks for that.
Mm-hmm. So you were with us here today. You've either joined us on Facebook or YouTube, and we say thank you for that. You know how else you can help us out? Like us and subscribe. Facebook or YouTube, both actually would work.
Mm-hmm.
We want to make sure that you are helping us by alerting to people that we are out there, that we're sharing the gospel, we have ministries, and we also want you to make sure that you don't miss out on any of the important events and the ministries that happen here at our church. So Facebook and YouTube, please like and subscribe.
Now back to our live streaming service.
I don't know what you're going to be facing this week. I'm not sure what challenges the enemy has in store for you, but I know that greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. So be comforted to know that you are walking in strength. You are walking with dignity. You are walking as a king and a queen that represents God himself. For he has bestowed in you his spirit so that you can spread love and joy everywhere you go. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord calls his face to shine upon you. May he lift up the light of his countenance and grant you peace. Have a happy Sabbath. Have a happy week. And we'll see you here on Tuesday for prayer meeting at 6:30. God bless.
We hope you enjoyed our live streaming service.
We would love to be able to connect with you. If you go to our website, under our Member Resources tab, there's a drop-down that has forms and registrations on it. On that page, you will find our connection card. If you would please fill it out, we would love the opportunity to be able to reach out to you.
We would love to see you next week.